Hey there, welcome to another installment of our daily devos. We're in the middle of a series called Chosen, and today I want to talk to you specifically about how you were chosen to fight. A couple of weeks ago, I got a piece of mail, and on it said jury duty. And I, like most people, when you get this, it's always the most inconvenient, the worst timing possible, yet you have to. So I go in and I do my civic duty, and I'm spending about my whole afternoon at the courthouse all the way in Pittsburgh for them to tell me that I had to come back the next day because they didn't have enough time to figure out if I was on the jury or not. The next day I show up and I was chosen as an alternate. So I had to sit through the whole process, yet I didn't even have a voice. The next day comes around and I find out that someone fell out of the jury, and so now I was chosen to be a part of the big leagues. And now I'm all super focused, I'm paying attention, and I take note in the lawyers, the prosecutor and the defense, how they're both fighting for what they believe to be true. And there's all this stuff going on there. They're saying the evidence that you're not representing my client correctly. Objection, Your Honor. The list goes on. It was a fight. There were no punches thrown, but let me tell you, there was conflict. It was heated. And it reminded me of something. That if these lawyers who have just met this person or believe this situation to be true, if they're willing to go fight for this person, man, shouldn't we as Christians be ready and willing to fight for the people around us? Unfortunately, we as people are really good at fighting against people, but I don't know how good we are at fighting for people. I want to turn your attention to the book of Luke, chapter 10, verse 30, and it's a story that a lot of us are probably very familiar with. It's even a term that's used by non-Christians, the Good Samaritan. There's a law called the Good Samaritan Law. And so let's unpack this first verse in this story. It says, Jesus replies, a Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead on the road. A couple of things popping out right here, right off the bat. But you know, what happens in this story, it can be translated into what's going on in 2020, right? I love the fact that it's a Jewish man and all these kind of things going on, but man, if we translate that to what's going on in 2020, we could probably see the same similar things. Now, maybe people aren't getting beat up. People aren't getting attacked on the side of the road and left for dead. But there are people who have been beat up by circumstances. There's people who are hurting because of the things that are going on in their life, because of relationships that are broken, promises that aren't being kept, expectations that aren't being met. There's people being neglected by friends, by family, by different things that they are expecting. And let me tell you, these people are waiting, just like the guy in this story. They're waiting for someone to come and fight for them. Just like the guy on the story, he sees these people. He sees a priest. He sees a Levite, and he sees a Samaritan. And every time he's sitting here waiting for someone to stop, to have compassion, to have enough care to be moved to action. And I think there's people in our inner circles, there's people, maybe our neighbors, there's coworkers, there's family members who've been beat up by life, and they're waiting for you to fight for them. A couple of observations for this, but I love this piece right here. People are being neglected by people they are anticipating that would stop and help them. This Jewish man sees a priest, and I bet you he's like, oh, priest, finally, someone who's going to help me, only to see the priest walk by. A Levite, oh, finally, one of my countrymen, only to see him walk by. And I wonder, when he sees the Samaritan, does he start to try to shy away from him? Or is he even conscious? Does he even know what's going on? Or is he like, oh, is he going to make it even worse? Is he going to put me out of my misery? Because he's expecting the Samaritan to not do what the Samaritan does. And there's people all around us, people who are expecting people to help them, only to see them not. And are we gonna stop and notice to fight for the people who are needing us to fight for them? I love this piece right here. I wrote down, differences don't allow for indifference. Did you catch that? There's so many reasons and ways for us to find differences in people around us, but let me tell you, that does not make room for you to be indifferent towards the things that they're struggling with. Man, take a look around us. There are so many people who are different than you, but there's so many of those same people struggling. Just because they're different, they look different, they talk different, they believe different things, because they vote red, they vote blue, because they have money, because they don't, because they work there or they work here. Those differences do not make room and excuse for you to be indifferent towards them. Fight for them. Fight for them to get better. Why? Because this story is a representation of how Jesus lived, and it's a model on how we should live. Jesus for sure saw the differences in people, yet every time Jesus is presented with an opportunity, he's extending compassion and grace. He's fighting for them. And we should do the same. So application, I have three words for us to apply this to our lives. The first one is do, the next is say, and then pray. Do, say, pray. Do something. I hope that you don't just stay in this theoretical mode where, man, I really should help people around me. No, you should be moved to compassion, which moves you to do some action. Do something for someone else. Say, what can you say for someone else who might be needing a word of encouragement, an uplifting thing? Maybe you need to write something or help someone out with the words that you speak over them. And then don't neglect prayer. In this time, in this season, with politics and division and sickness, don't discount what prayer can do through you for someone else. Do something, say something, pray, fight for the people around you. Let me pray. God, you're awesome, you're amazing. We love you and praise you, Jesus, for who you are. Lord, I thank you that this story is a representation of your attitude toward us. God, we're different than you. We're less than you. God, thank you that that's not a reason for you to show indifference toward us. So God, help us to have compassion and fight for the people around us who are waiting for us to do something, to say something, and to pray. God, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great rest of your day.